results, avoiding radical surgery, maintaining your sexual and urinary function, and your life. Most insurances, Medicare, Medicaid accepted. Hi, I'm Dr. Gil Lederman. Call us at 212-CHOICES, 212-CHOICES for a fresh second opinion and a free booklet DVD. Conveniently located in Manhattan at 38th and Broadway. For your custom-tailored prostate cancer treatment, call 212-CHOICES, 212-CHOICES. Cherish your life with custom-tailored prostate cancer treatment at Radio Surgery New York.
Welcome back to the Radio Surgery Hour. This is Rob Redstone here with Dr. Gil Lederman at the WOR Studios in the heart of New York City. We're just a few steps from the Radio Surgery New York Cancer Treatment Center on Broadway and 38th Street. Dr. Lederman, the leading cancer expert, treats prostate cancer non-invasively. He was the first in New York with fractionated brain radiosurgery, and he's the first in America and in the Western Hemisphere with body radiosurgery. You can also call Dr. Lederman at 212-CHOICES for a free informative booklet and DVD. Hey, Dr. Lederman, we're back.
We're back. We're back live at WOR. If you have questions, again, call us at 212-CHOICES. I'm here with Rob Spencer. So we were talking about the history of breast cancer. 100 years ago, people were getting super radical mastectomies.
Mm-hmm.
Then there were studies that showed that doing super radical surgery didn't really help. Cutting off all your normal tissues doesn't help. In fact, it hurts you. It limits your action. Can be painful, debilitating. And over the last 30 years, the biggest progress was actually showing you don't need to remove the breast at all. A woman can have breast cancer, and 200, 250,000 women a year have breast cancer. You don't need to remove the breast. You can live a normal life for most women having the breast. And that's there are exceptions, of course. So I'm not saying every woman, but I'm talking about the majority of women. When I came to New York from Harvard in 1987, Sloan Kettering published their data, and they showed that at their institution in 1987, about 97% of their patients were getting mastectomy.
Mm-hmm.
The same year at Harvard, 90% of women were getting lumpectomy and radiation.
Mm.
So if you had breast cancer in Boston, you were living with your breast intact. In New York, you were living most likely with mastectomy.
Yeah.
So there's biases in the healthcare system, and I'm sure you've seen it in your short medical career that certain doctors do it one way, other doctors do it another way, and sometimes the patient doesn't understand what's on the other side of the wall.
Yeah, I've definitely seen that.
So for a person to get a second opinion, the idea is to find out what someone else is thinking. And the biggest mistake, in my view, is when patients tell me, okay, Dr. Lederman, what would you do? And then the patient says, well, I'm going to go back and talk to my doctor and see what he says. Well, your doctor's already told you what he says.
Right.
You know, if your doctor's told you, I'm going to do a mastectomy on you, and Dr. Lederman's going to do a lumpectomy and save my breast, what do you think, doctor? It puts the doctor in a very defensive position.
Sure.
So what's he going to say? I was wrong and Dr. Lederman's right? Probably not.
Definitely
he's probably going to say that idiot. He doesn't know what I know.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really help to go back to your own doctor. That's why we tell people it's better to get a fresh second opinion. Look at it in a fresh way. Start completely new. Give the patients the reports. Let the patient investigate themselves. I had a patient who called me yesterday whose mother, beloved mother, has brain lymphoma, actually has a lymphoma of the chest, was treated with chemotherapy. The woman is about 85. She's very fragile. And the cancer spread to the brain. There's one nodule that's 5 centimeters, and the doctors want to use whole brain radiation, which is to radiate her entire brain, and give a chemotherapy called methotrexate. Now, methotrexate and brain radiation is very toxic. There's late effects, and there's severe neurologic effects that damage the brain. And the woman's function is already borderline.
Mm-hmm.
The family asked me, what would I do? I said, well, first of all, I want to see the records. I want to see the MRIs and make sure that everything is fine. But if it's a solitary mass of lymphoma in someone so fragile, why not just do radiosurgery? We focus on that tumor, we treat the tumor, and avoid harm to the healthy brain.
Yeah.
And the doctors in the hospital want to do whole brain and methotrexate, which is very toxic.
Mm.
And I just personally don't understand it. So the family's in the middle, and they went to the doctors in the hospital and said, well, Dr. Lederman says to do radiosurgery. And the doctors said at the hospital, well, we never do that. It's not done.
Yeah.
So the woman goes online. She goes on Google and punches in brain lymphoma and radiosurgery, and she finds out, yeah, it's done.
Okay.
So now she's torn between the doctors who are taking care of her in the hospital, who want to do one thing, which I think is pretty toxic, and my treatment, which is a lot easier.
Yeah.
So they're torn, and it's hard to go back to their doctors and say, Dr. Lederman says this, and you say that, and who's right?
Right. Right.
I mean, they're the protagonist. How can the protagonist be the judge?
Well, the radiosurgery is far less invasive.
Well, it's totally non-invasive, number one. It's non-invasive, but it's more than that. Whole brain radiation radiates all the healthy brain.
Yeah.
And this woman's function, I mean, everyone wants their brain intact. You want your brain intact, right?
Yes.
You don't want anyone to hurt your beautiful brain.
I do not.
You spend 25 years working on your brain to get to this point. Your brain has a lot of information in it, right?
Highly trained.
You're a medical student. Everyone wants to keep their brain. They have their memories, their thoughts. And why do you want some treatment that can harm the brain?
Yeah.
So like we just had a caller a few minutes ago, a 35-year-old with a brain tumor. They want everything that they can have also to protect that 35-year-old brain. Everyone wants to protect the brain.
Right.
So you can understand why it's so hard, even in this day and age. And you can imagine when we started brain radiosurgery, we were the first in New York with brain radiosurgery. Everyone was saying, oh, it's experimental, it's unproven, it's charlatan. And now we're out there, people accept it finally, but then the question is, do they do it or do they still go back to the old treatment? So we heard it yesterday, I heard it today, and it keeps on going on. I want to talk a little bit more about breast cancer and the evolution of treatment. So we talked about how cancer went from super radical mastectomy to radical mastectomy to modified radical mastectomy. And believe me, when they went to modified radical mastectomy, surgeons thought it was the greatest thing in the world because all of a sudden women could keep the function of the arm.
Sure.
They kept those muscles. So they thought they were really improving something. The woman saw it, of course, as deforming, and it was very deforming, but it was a step in the right direction, keeping the function. And also, if you kept the muscles, there was more form of the chest than if there was no muscles. Otherwise, there was just the skin over the ribs.
Yeah.
Then the NSABP, which is a National Surgical Adjuvant Bowel and Breast Project, a group of surgeons put together a randomized study of thousands of women, and the thousands of women were randomly allocated either to lumpectomy or mastectomy with breast cancer. Either removing the lump of cancer and radiating or removing the whole breast. And the studies show that you have the same survival if you keep the breast or don't keep the breast. And so it was scientific proof that allowed women to make that decision.
Yeah.
And that's how women got to the point of having a choice between keeping the breast and losing the breast. No one's forcing a woman to keep her breast. Sometimes women think if they lose the breast, they're going to be better off.
Right.
But the scientific facts for most women don't show that. And I'm talking about the usual woman who has a lump of cancer. You do not need to lose the breast. So then the next step in this evolution, and this, remember, this is taking 100 years. We're talking about 100 years of history in 10 minutes. The next step was to say, can we shorten the course of radiation?
Okay.
Because, for example, in Canada, where people live often far from treatment centers, Canada doesn't have radiation centers around the corner. So studies were done, randomized study with thousands of women. Do you need 5 weeks of radiation, or can you do it in 16 treatments, half as many treatments?
Mm-hmm.
And it took 10 years to do the study and 10 years to follow the patients. And now we have the data that a woman with breast cancer can actually be treated in half the time.
Okay.
And have the same chance of being cancer-free and the same chance of good cosmetic results.
Mm-hmm.
And I often still see women who are being told they need 5 or 6 weeks of daily radiation when, in fact, the studies show you don't. You can be treated a lot faster. So the whole goal of cancer treatment is to try to impact the patient's life less, to harm them less, and give them better results.
Now, is radiosurgery applicable to breast cancer?
Okay, so radiosurgery is applicable. And that's actually the next study. So the first, we can imagine this, the course of things. So removing the whole breast with the muscles, with the ribs, removing the whole breast with the muscles, removing the whole breast without the muscles, then removing the lump of cancer, leaving the breast.
Yeah.
Then radiating the whole breast, then radiating the whole breast in less time. So the next step is obviously what you just said,
right,
focusing just on the cancer area. And it's called partial breast irradiation.
Mm-hmm.
And it's certainly being done. The studies are not as conclusive as the other studies. They're still ongoing, so it's early on. The cosmetic results are not as good because you're focusing more treatment on a smaller area
mm-hmm.
in less time. So it's being done, it's being studied, but there's already pretty good results radiating the whole breast, and most of those studies show excellent results.
Mm-hmm.
So it keeps on going. There's a lot of work about breast cancer.
Sure.
And for the woman, it means that if you have a lump of cancer or you have a lump in your breast and you don't know what it is, because we've had many women come to us since this show started with a lump in the breast and they're too embarrassed to go to their doctor, please come to us, please come to your doctor, please get that lump diagnosed. And if you haven't had a mammogram, have a mammogram. A 250,000 women have breast cancer a year, and there's no reason to die unnecessarily, right?
Definitely.
They also reported data here showing Black women and some minority women have less good results than white women. Remember mm-hmm. that?
Yeah,
we talked about that.
Yeah,
and we talked about the delay.
That's right.
So it's hard to believe in a way, but it's also easy to believe in another way, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this week I had a Black woman, come to me. She had a lump in the breast she felt this spring in March.
Okay.
She ends up going to the doctor and gets a biopsy in May.
Mm-hmm.
She has another biopsy in June.
Okay.
She gets mastectomy in July.
Mm-hmm.
Now she's getting treated at, she has Medicaid.
Right.
Okay, so sometimes people with bad insurance seem to get worse care for some reason. Maybe the question is, what comes first, the chicken or the egg?
Yeah,
right. So she comes to me this week. She's had a mastectomy now.
Mm-hmm.
Had a mastectomy in July. She's coming to me this week, which is October.
Right.
She was diagnosed in May. She felt the cancer in March.
Right.
Okay, so from March, which is the third month, to October, it's 7 months.
Yeah.
And she's had really only surgical treatment 7 months later. And we've looked at the data, why people, poor people, Black people get worse results. Remember, men with prostate cancer in the Black community have 200% higher mortality rate because of delay.
Mm-hmm.
Not because stage for stage the outcome's different. It's delay.
Right.
They're letting the cancer grow. So the woman came to me on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday afternoon, we got a PET scan. So we had her staged up. We got blood tests, PET scan. We knew exactly the situation. The cancer is confined.
Okay.
Okay, so there's still, thank God, no spread. 7 months after it appeared.
Yeah.
I told her that she needs to start treatment. She needs treatment for the breast cancer. Now she's going to a doctor elsewhere to have reconstruction of the breast. She's 39 years old. And all she can think about is getting that breast reconstructed. And all our surgeon is telling her about is getting reconstruction. So they've taken from, the surgeon started with her in May. It's now October. They're still not done with her. And she's still not wanting to start for treatment.
Hmm.
And it's such a dilemma. And I talked to her, and she came with two very good friends who were very supportive of her. And they understood very well, the friends. You need to treat the cancer first. And you can reconstruct the breast.
Right.
And she's already chosen to have the breast removed. And a reconstructed breast never really looks the same, unless you're probably Angelina Jolie, who probably had pre-programmed super-duper reconstruction. And she probably didn't lose the whole breast. She probably had a subcutaneous mastectomy. This woman lost the whole breast. She has lots of scars. She had a pretty good-sized tumor. She had a lymph node that was positive. She